I can't, I don't understand how it does that. One can sort of analyze it, et cetera, et cetera. But I mean, one feels like, I'll just take an example. He has a curtain drawn to one side. He has the river outside and the arch of the bridge. He has a still life on this table, and he has this part of the window, the vertical light part of the window, which comes in a great vertical up here. And one feels, actually, there's this, a palpable feeling of there that curtain is, and behind this upright of the window is that arch outside, mind you, that the still life is just where it should be. There's a real distance between this point and that point, between that point and this point, between that point and this point, etc. Everything seems to be in its right place. Now, the final structure he involves in his struggle, because it is a struggle, you can see that guy worked his guts out. I mean, he pushed and he pushed and he pushed and he really hit it so beautifully. I mean, good Lord, the differences between, for instance, the kind of weight and density he gets to that great gray form here, and then the gray that he gets down here, the sort of very concentrated greenish gray that he gets down here underneath the window, pulls apart like that. The difference between the orangey ochre that he gets here and the more pronounced orangey brown that he gets here and pulls apart, it's amazing. And then to get this full sensation of the bed there, the bed in space, that Tanmien read of the bed with the frontal plane softly put, and then a thicker Tanmien red coming here and coming up here. It's just amazing. And look at the drawing board with the drawing on it and see what happens there. See what happens with this plane and then how he hits it with this green. Wow. What he does is that I think he had unparalleled access to the vital forces inside him. That's all. That's the only way I can explain it. So that he trusted his instinct, and he had his, as I mentioned earlier, he had these enormous gifts, and trusting his instinct and having his enormous gifts, he's able to sort of penetrate and get this marvelous, it's one of the great, great masterpieces of 20th century painting. And of course, it's what I guess you'd call the heroic period of Matisse. Not that all through his life he remained Matisse, and he did many, many great things in every period that he has, including great paintings in the Nice period, which until recently has been almost universally despised by the museums. Another remarkable thing he does, he gets this drawing to be out here in space, but he gets those to stay on the wall. Just try that. And he even gets the gleam of the light that comes through the window to hit that, and he keeps that light plane in place there. Try to anchor these things in space. That is absolutely almost impossible. And yet he did it, and I can't bless him enough. To me, this painting used to overwhelm me at this museum. I'd come and sit at it and draw from it, look at it, and eat it up, and I still can do that. And another painting, now we're going to go from the 20th century to the 18th century. I've never seen the Chardin hang as well here. I think the light was so stood on the Chardin here. And I think this is exactly the same way we're talking about the Matisse and the paintings downstairs. Here's a man who understood so well how to work with planes of color and move you in and out and describe what happens with the drama of the plums in a silver bowl, the two pieces of fruit here in the foreground with a plum pit, the peach at the side of this marvelous picture. And how does he do that, How does he, it's the same principle, of course, that Matisse is using in there. Let's examine a bit this teardrop form of a light plane that he has on the picture, and what it does there, and how it comes around here into the handle. You see how he's done that, and then you see the shadow on the picture. It makes a cadence, it goes like that, and then it hooks and comes here, and it goes wham, and kicks the boom like that into the peach. And then you see the peach, and what he's done with that peach, the cleft division of the peach, each cheek of the peach, this ding, 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 the lights on the peach, and how he picked up on those lights and kept down on the other reflections. How many times do I see you painting or see myself painting and say, Jesus, I mean, you want to make a thing here, you make a traffic jam. You instead of, when Chardin does it, it's again like in the Matisse, he has a blue, almost horizontal, that thing sits on. See the little blue plane that peach sits on? He has these reflected lights, one, two here, and then he has those, one, this little configuration here, much sharper, and they're so sharp and so insistent, they immediately pick up what happens with this huge blaze of light that occurs here, which is hitting the contrast of this great capping of a dark form here. And then he picks up a few other lights, the marvelous lights that come here and the lights that come here, and the thing begins to exist there and changes is so marvelous. Look at the change he gets, the change even between that blue that's here and the lighter thing that happens here, which sort of continues like in the tail of that picture there. And that configuration of the shadows streaming like this. And then you really feel as though there's space here. And look what he does here. There's a reflected light on this part of the basket, and he really moves you behind. As in the Matisse, this miraculous thing, he feels how you go behind. You actually go behind the picture, and you come to what happens here. And you do a marvelous thing with these two reds here, and soft, keeping that down. He begins to do a front with each one of these pieces of fruit. It's incredible. And this is not a very late Chardin. I mean, to me, Chardin went further and further, got better and better, but it's a masterpiece by him. He had this innocent, direct access to the phenomena of the appearances in front of him. And yet he was a painter, I think, that painted again and again and again on her work. He never made that much money. His contemporaries made more money because he would take so long to carry out these paintings. He would work with, as he put it, you know, with the paint rag in one hand and the paintbrush in the other hand, wiping off and putting on, constantly adjusting and working in. But marvelous painting. There's so many things. I think maybe I'll go into the Bun Art Room, then come out and see the Van Gogh and the Cezanne. Oh, here comes my
cameraman.
My cameraman. Okay. Is Farris carrying that apparatus for me? Or can I start? Oh, when I said downstairs that there was this Ruault with the three figures and the Bonnard opposite, this is the Bonnard that was opposite. And what always fascinated me about that painting, about this painting, was this sort of guillotine blade of that dark form of the window shade, which has a slight precarious feeling to it. I always felt something a bit ominous, as though, you know, tremendous weight that will drop. And that in itself is extraordinary, that he gives you the sensation of this deep, heavy weight there and that void outside there, and how cleverly he knows how to do this. If he does the deck chair, which comes in on this beautiful diagonal, and it has this lovely head of the woman here and the little head of the cat. Look how discreet he is. He modulates all over the place. I mean, he shows you the features, the eyes, the nose, even the open mouth and the reflected light on the lips. He shows you her hair. He shows you the gleam of light on her hand. And yet he keeps that all within one beat, within one measure. So one really is seeing what happens with that patch of red against this blue that comes pulsing in here. He knows how to work things like that in the most marvelous way. And he gets this slightly acrid, slightly sour, sweet thing of a note, he'll bring that crazy bluish, greenish, blue turquoise thing here. He goes, meow, like that. And it's marvelous. Or he puts that green up here. And this mysterious, deep treatment of the vegetation, it had a great effect on me, this painting. I mean, I look at it, I say, wow, this really gets me about that. I must say, it hasn't lessened through the years. I still come to it. I'm still in a bit of awe as I look at it. But all through, when you look at Bonnard, he's such a deceptive painter. This painting used to hang occasionally, and there's a large room in the old mansion, I guess. I used to come upstairs and I'd sit there at leisure and draw. And I remember this painting hanging and thinking how beautifully he would control, you know, the one that's in the Met of the terrace, with that big India rubber tree and that abrupt drop from the terrace into the valley. And here he has that same sensation of dropping down like that, and you get these marvelous things of the roofs happening here, and the great frond of palm leaf coming here, and the vegetation to one side here, and the vegetation to the other here, and this absolutely daring, nutty thing of having this vertical form of the woman holding something in her hand, a cup of berries or blossoms or God knows what, and he has a light thing here, but he keeps that down in that gray, blue, nacreous kind of color that he keeps here. It's amazing what control he has. He keeps it like that, but look at this light thing that goes behind her in space. See that light horizontal that goes behind her there? Wow, what control he got. And to think of Bonnard painting this thing again, I think of Ruoff and his little place. I think of Giacometti and his cramped little studio. I think of Bonnard working in hotel bedrooms with florid French wallpaper, or working in his little studio, Le Tenet, taking a roll of canvas and tacking it to the wall, and maybe doing this painting here and that painting on the same roll, and not even, you know, not sort of saying here's an exact dimension for the painting, but sort of just feeling his way, and then he'll do that painting.